Well, good morning. And we are awful light again today. Obviously, folks are traveling again. Obviously, let's see, the churches are in Kenai and the Croziers are going down the Elkan or something, I guess. I'm not sure, so. Look around, see, during the week, just double check with folks that are not here and see if they need reminding to attend worship. Our opening hymn this morning will be Walking in Sunlight, 708, Walking in Sunlight. Walking in sunlight all over my journey, over the mountain, through the deep vale. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee, promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Alleluia, I am rejoicing, singing the praises, Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light, in him is no darkness. Ever I'm walking close to his side. Heavenly sunlight,
flooding my soul with glory divine.
Alleluia, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Alleluia, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. Our next hymn will be number 397. Let the lower lights be burning, 397. Brian will lead us in prayer following this hymn. Brightly beams our Father's mercy from his lighthouse evermore. But to us he gives the keeping of the lights along the shore. Let the lower lights be burning, send a gleam across the wave. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save. Dark the night of sin is settled, loud the angry billows roar. Eager eyes are watching, longing of the lights along the shore. Let the lower lights be burning, send a gleam across the wave. Some struggling seamen, you may rescue, you may save. Trim your feeble lamp, my brother. Some poor sailor tempest tossed, trying now to make the harbor in the darkness made. Let alone. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save.
Bow with me, please. Father, we are so thankful for this time. So thankful for all that you give us, dear Lord. Dear Lord, we just pray that as we go through this service today, that you help us to let go of the outside world, to let us focus on you and what we've learned here, what we fill our hearts with your joy, your word, your love. Just pray that you'll be with those who are unable to be here today. For sickness, give them strength. Be with the doctors to help them. For spiritual weakness, give them strength. And give us the ability to touch their hearts and bring them back to you. Dear Lord, we just pray that you will help us to touch those around us on our daily walk, to be able to be the Christians we're supposed to be able to bring people to the light and help them in their way and their walk with you. We just pray this all in Christ's name. Amen.
Let's turn over to number 700. To the walk, to the work, 700. to the work, we are servants of God. Let us follow a path that the Master has trod. Soul our strength to renew, let us do with our mind what our hands find anew. Toiling on, let us hope, let us walk. The fountain of life, let the weary be led. In the cross of the glory shall be, while we hope the tidings salvation is free. Toiling on, let us hope, let us watch, and let it the Master comes. To the work, there is labor for all, for the kingdom of darkness and error shall fall, and the name of Jehovah exalted shall be in the loud swelling chorus. Salvation is free. Toiling on, let us hope, let us walk. The next hymn will be number 572. 572. Send the light. And we will not sing verse 3. And as we sing this song, think about who that light is. There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless way. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And the golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore.
Our song before the Lord's Supper is offered this morning will be number 12. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? Number 12.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Was it for crimes that I have done he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in. When Christ the mighty maker died for man the creature's sin, thus might I hide my blushing face while his dear cross appears. Dissolve my heart in thankfulness and melt mine eyes to tears, but dry repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Michael?
In Matthew 26, we read where Jesus himself instituted the Lord's Supper when he said to take the bread and eat it as his body, and to drink the fruit of the vine as if it was his blood. And I got the impression from a little reading there that the apostles themselves didn't quite take that seriously. If you look after this, they were discussing amongst themselves who it was going to be that betrayed Jesus. And that's right after he gave these emblems. And then a little further on, they were arguing about who was the greatest among them. And it doesn't seem like they were focused on taking the Lord's Supper with Jesus himself. And sometimes it might be difficult for us to focus. Jesus knows how busy we are and how many important things that we have going on in our lives, but he asked us to remember him specifically when we take of these emblems. Jesus told Peter that he would deny him, and Peter disagreed with that stringently. In fact, he said that if Jesus was to die, that he would even die with him. And all of the apostles said the same thing, so will we. But we see when Jesus was arrested, also in Matthew 26, how many disciples fled? All of them. They all abandoned Jesus. And I think that's where 1 Corinthians 11 comes in, that we are to examine ourselves. And I think that's when the apostles truly examined themselves in their relationship to Christ, because we read of many great works of the apostles after this point. So right now we're focused in our worship on remembering Jesus as he asked us to do. And would you please bow with me as we give thanks for the bread. Heavenly Father, we know that you suffered greatly in your body. We can't comprehend it, but we know you did this because you loved us. You want to redeem us. And as we take of this emblem, this unleavened bread, together, we pray that we might remember your sacrifice, your suffering for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray. Dear Lord, Father in heaven, Lord, as we bow our heads once again in humble prayer, Lord, we focus our minds in remembrance of the blood that you shed on that cross, the sacrifice that you made so that we may one day be with you in heaven. Lord, we pray that you will give us the strength to endure the trials of this world and to remember that your sacrifice was greater than anything that we may face in our lives. We pray this all in your Son's holy name. Amen.
We're also commanded to give as we've prospered, and it's following command in the New Testament. And one of the scriptures we looked at in our Bible class this morning, the people were convinced that their wealth came from the might of their own hands. Right after that, they were reminded that the strength to work and gain wealth was given to them by God. That's a good reminder for us today. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, we're grateful for all of your blessings. We think now of the material blessings we have and ask that we be of a pure and generous heart as we give back to support the work of the local church here. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our song before the scripture reading and then Michael's lesson will be number 396. Lift him up, 396. And if you're able, please stand as we sing. How to reach the masses, men of every birth. For an answer, Jesus gave a key. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Lift him up, lift him up. Still he speaks from eternity. If world is hungry for the living bread. Lift the Savior up for them to sing. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, still he speaks from eternity. And I, if I be lifted up from the dead, shall draw men unto me. Don't exalt the preacher, don't exalt the pew. Preach the gospel simple, full, and free. Prove him
and you will find that promise
is true. I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, lift him up. Be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Lift him up by living as a Christian ought. Let the world in you the Savior see. Then men will gladly follow him. Who once said, I'll draw all men unto me. Lift him up, still he speaks from eternity. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me.
Bruce?
This morning's scripture reading comes from Philippians chapter 2, verse 16. Holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain.
Good morning, my beautiful friends and family in Christ. It's always a blessing to be able to come before you and preach another portion of God's word and know that those that are here are listening with the intent to learn and understand what they're hearing. This morning we're going to look into shining as lights by holding fast the word of life, as our brother just read in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 16. By holding fast to the word of life, we establish our conviction in the truth of the word. Over the past few weeks, we've been considering how we can help people come to the Lord by shining as lights in the world. We looked at just shining as lights and how we are to shine as lights. Secondly, by living as saints in this world. Third, by doing all things without grumbling or complaining. Fourth, by being children of God without fault. And now, by holding fast the word of life. Let's turn to Philippians chapter 2, and we'll begin in verse 12. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 12. Philippians 2, 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God, without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Essential to our ability to shine as lights in the world is that we hold fast the word of life, as we just read, and as our brother just read in verse 16 of Philippians chapter 2. Holding fast to the word of life establishes our unwavering belief in it. Christians are not to ebb and flow when it comes to their commitment to God's word. We hold fast the words of life. We establish our convictions in the truth of the word. But how do we hold fast the word of life and use it as a tool to help some come to Christ? Well, today we're going to look at a few ways. First, we need to diligently study the word. We need to apply the word to our own life. Then we need to teach the word. To fully understand how to hold fast the word of life and use it as a tool to help some come to Christ, we must first diligently study the word. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15 with me. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Paul writes to Timothy here, study, well, the first word, right? Or be diligent in the New King James Version, but I like the King James Version of this. Study, he says. Why? To show yourself approved unto God, a workman who needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing or accurately handling the word of God. How do we show ourselves to be approved unto God? Study. Be diligent to present yourselves approved by studying his word. The word of truth is what? It's the gospel. Let's look at Ephesians. Go back with me just a couple of books to Ephesians chapter 1 and look at verse 13. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth. What's the word of truth? The gospel of your salvation. And whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. This is the word of truth. This is what we are to study diligently. Paul is telling Timothy that before God, he needs to be diligent to show himself tested and proven acceptable, above reproach, with no shame in what he is teaching, cutting straight to the point regarding the gospel. Study so nobody can look at you and say, you don't know what you're talking about. Study God's word. Let's read Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 2 in correlation to this. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 2. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 2. The proverb writer writes, the tongue of the wise uses knowledge rightly, but the mouth of fools pours forth foolishness. Study so you can handle accurately God's word and use knowledge rightly, not foolishly. We need to see the need to study as God's children. Let's consider 1 Timothy. Go back with me to the epistles to Timothy, and we'll go into the 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning in verse 3. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Beginning in verse 3. If anyone teaches otherwise and does not consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which accords with his godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but is obsessed with disputes and arguments over words, for which come envy, strife, reviling, evil suspicions, useless wranglings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. From such withdraw yourself. We study so we speak through knowledge and wisdom, not so we can have some kind of selfish gain. Oh, I'm better than you because I know more about the Bible than you do. God says you don't talk like that. Oh, I'm better than you because look at me, I'm a good Christian. No, that's not why we study. We don't study to put it into people's faces. Excuse me. Look at verses 20 and 21 here. Paul tells Timothy, oh, Timothy. There's an exclamation point there. As he's calling out to him, oh, Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. Preach and teach and evangelize this and only this. Don't add to it. Don't take away from it. Study this and teach this word. Rather than leading others to God, we might instead increase to more ungodliness. Professing themselves to be wise, they became as fools, right? Note Paul's warnings through inspiration to Titus in his epistle to Titus, chapter 2, beginning in verse 7. In all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works. You know, the thing is, a pattern doesn't just happen like that. A pattern happens over your life. We're supposed to show ourselves to be a pattern of good works. In doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say about you. Boy, you better make sure that when you are talking about God's word as a Christian, that you are sound of speech, that you have integrity, and that you are perfect in your doctrine. Look at chapter 3, verses 9 through 11 here. Avoid foolish disputes, genealogies, contentions, and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and useless. Reject a divisive man after the first and second admonition. Now look this up. You know, admonition is a warning. If this man continues to speak ungodly things and try to twist and distort this word, he gets two warnings. And then you avoid him completely, knowing that such a person is warped and sinning, being self-condemned. Know this word. Study this word. That is our life as a Christian. We need to show a longing for this word. Like a newborn baby longs for its mother's milk, Peter writes. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2. Peter writes, through inspiration, okay, God speaking here. As newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. I want you to think about a little baby, a newborn baby. They're so precious, right? Beautiful, innocent, pure. What's the one thing that drives you crazy about a newborn baby? Right? All constantly with the screaming and the crying. Why? Because they are always hungry for mother's milk. They're always hungry, day in and day out. They wake you up in the middle of the night because they're hungry and they need that milk. That's how we're supposed to be with this word. Day and night. Constantly wanting to be in this word, wanting to study this word, wanting to know this word. That's how we're supposed to be, like little babies that want milk. We want this word like that. We cannot live without having it constantly in our minds and in our hearts. We need to be ready to receive the word with meekness and implanting it in our hearts. Let's consider James chapter 1 and verse 21. Turn with me to James chapter 1, verse 21, just a few pages back. James writes, Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. Receive the word with humility. That's what this means. Take it in all humbleness. Thank you, Lord, for giving me this. I must study this word. Think about Psalm 111, or 119, sorry, and verse 11. Psalm 119 and verse 11. This is the very first memory verse they gave us when we went to school at MSOP. You know why? Because its message is strong. And they wanted us to understand why they were asking us to memorize so much of the Bible. Psalm 119 and verse 11. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. We study to know God's word. Not just on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. We study it day in and day out, like a baby wanting it all the time, putting it in our minds so we can walk the way he wants us to walk in the light. We need to take advantage of every opportunity that we have, not just to study it on our own, but to study it with others. And we touched on this a little bit in Bible class this morning, but I want you to turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25. The Hebrew writer writes here in verse 25 of Hebrews chapter 10, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Like I said in Bible class this morning, does this say not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together for Sunday morning worship? For Sunday morning Bible class? For Wednesday evening Bible class? No. Anytime you have an opportunity to spend in fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ, to study God's word with one another, to dive into it, that's what you're supposed to do. Don't forsake those times. Love God's word. Love your brother. Take every advantage, every opportunity you have to study it with each other. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 13. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 13, he says, and again, oops, sorry, 3 and verse 13, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Exhort each other weekly on Sunday. Is that what it says? Exhort each other twice a week, once on Sunday and once on Wednesday. No. Exhort each other daily while it is called today. Every day is called today, is it not? We're to exhort each other every day, and not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as is the habit of some, every day, while it is called today. Now, read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 11 with me. Go back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 11. Therefore, Paul writes, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. Comfort each other, edify one another. While it is called today, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as is the habit of some. Every day in the word, loving each other enough to fellowship with one another. Our fellowship and our study of this word, there's nothing more important than that. Nothing. Turn to Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 24 now. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 24. And what does Paul write right before he says not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together? He says, and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. So we meet together as often as possible to study and exhort one another while it is called today, so that way we can stir one another up in order to stir up love and good works. Well, right? Our life is supposed to be a pattern of good works, is it not? Didn't we just read that? Our life is a pattern of good works. How can we have a pattern of good works if we're not stirring one another up in fellowship daily while it is called today to have that pattern of good works? It's our job to be in each other's lives every single day, fellowshipping and loving one another and studying God's word. If we're going to hold fast the word of life in a way that will help us shine as lights and lead others to Christ, we must start by preparing our hearts to study it diligently. So, to fully understand how to hold fast the word of life and use it as a tool to help some come to Christ, we must first study the word diligently. But we must also apply the word. We cannot merely be hearers of the word. Look at James chapter 1 and verse 22. James chapter 1, beginning in verse 22. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Well, that means that just coming to church on Sunday and listening to the service isn't enough, right? We have to be doers of the word, not just hearers, not just those who come and sit in the pew and listen to the word, but those who are doing it daily, while it is called today, right? For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. Always doing God's will. Everything we do, everything we say, to the glory of God. Colossians 3:17, right? Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. We even have a whole song about that. We do everything in his name, every single day. To hear and not apply will deprive others of an opportunity to know the word. When we apply the word, we show the value of God's will for humanity. Let's consider Romans chapter 12. Go back to Romans chapter 12. And look at verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Paul writes to the Christians in Rome, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Presenting your body as a sacrifice to God is a reasonable service. This isn't unreasonable, people. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We give ourselves as a sacrifice to God to do his will while it is called today, every day. Let us consider also 1 Peter chapter 1. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 13. Peter writes, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. How are we supposed to act? As obedient children. Obedient children. We are not our own. We are God's children. This body is not our own. We give it as a sacrifice to God to do his will. Do his will. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. In verse 19, Paul writes, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? This isn't mine. I mean, I walk around in this meat suit, but the day I gave my life to Christ, I sacrificed this to God and said, do with me as you will. Galatians 2:20, right? I'm crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Everything I do, everything we say, is to be to the glory of God. Everything. Excuse me. Though some might not be willing to listen to God's word, some might think differently if we demonstrate it in our lives that his way is the best and only way. Let's see what we can glean from 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Peter writes, through inspiration, so God's telling him to write this, wives, likewise be submissive to your own husbands. That this is the part I want to focus on here. That even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives, when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. It's about the way we live. Not us being up in people's faces, not us bolstering our knowledge so we can be better than people, but our example, just like he said about the wives, their example could possibly bring their husbands to salvation. Just because they are submissive to their husbands and they're submissive to God, they don't even have to say a word. Just what they do can bring their husbands to salvation. Just like just what we can do can bring others to know the word. Now look back at chapter 2. Chapter 2 of 1 Peter and verse 21. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. Our example is Christ. What did Christ do? He gave up everything to come to this earth, to live a life here, to preach for 3.5 years, to die on a cross so we could be saved. He did God's will the entire time he was on this earth, not sinning one time. Lived a perfect life. That's our example. And that's the example we should be trying to put across to others. Now, we're humans, and God knows that we're going to sin, and we're not perfect. But we can still strive to live that good life by applying the word to our lives. If we're going to hold fast the word of life in a way that will help us shine as lights and lead others to Christ, we must live out that word by applying it to our lives. So, again, to fully understand how to hold fast the word of life and use it as a tool to help some come to Christ, we must first study the word diligently, leading us to the application of it in our lives, and then we must teach the word. Although our actions can help lead some to Christ, in the end, no one is saved without hearing the word. Just seeing us live as good Christians, that's not enough. They have to hear the word, right? Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8. Here in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. You have been saved by grace through faith." Well, Romans 10:17 said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith doesn't come by watching somebody live godly. That can bring them to the point of wanting to hear God's word. And then they can have faith and grow in that. The proclamation of God's word is our primary responsibility as Christians. There is nothing more important in our lives than teaching this word to the lost. There shouldn't be, anyway. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 9. Peter tells us that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his, God's, own special people. Why is he telling us this? That you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy but now have obtained mercy. We are the people of God. We have obtained mercy. We are his holy priesthood, his nation. We are his people, and our job is to proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That is our number one job: to save lost souls by telling them about the word that we study and apply to our own lives. Because he doesn't want anybody to be lost. And sometimes people think, well, God, you know, he doesn't care who's lost or saved. Well, let's look at, excuse me, my eyes are getting blurry. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, patient toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God doesn't want anybody to go to hell. He wants everybody to be saved. And how does he do that? He sends us to teach his word. We see that all throughout the word. God doesn't just go, listen to me, here's my word, and do it. He sends somebody every single time, every single time, even to Saul when he was converted. It's our job. It is through the proclamation of God's word that we have the greatest hope of shining as lights and bringing others to him. God has called us through his gospel out of darkness into his marvelous light, out of sin into righteousness. As we endeavor to shine as lights with the help of the word, which we use to call us into God's marvelous light, it will also help others to come to him. Teaching is the natural outcome of study and application. If you study this and study it day in and day out, like God says, whether you're on your own or you're with your brothers and sisters in Christ, and you take what you study and you apply it to your life, the next step is to teach it. You can't help but teach it if you're applying this to your life. Teaching is the natural outcome of study and application. But many people like to teach and then study, which is not how you do it. You don't teach this word and then go back and study it and make sure that you're right. You study it to make sure that you're right, and then you teach it. But if we have adequately studied and applied God's word, people will take note and seek to know more about the way we are. We don't have to say a word for them to seek to want to know more. But this is the example given throughout the entire New Testament. Think about the disciples of Jesus Christ. Think about Paul and how he or Saul and how he became Paul. Think about Apollos when he was taught the word more perfectly. Think about the disciples of Apollos in Acts chapter 19 when Paul taught them the word more perfectly. They all learned the truth from the inspired apostles, from the inspired men, and they took that truth out and taught it to others. They didn't just sit on the truth. They taught it. All of them did. By being shining lights in this world, we can help others come to Christ. We are shining lights if we hold fast the word of life. We hold fast the word of life in three ways. We diligently study the word. We aptly apply the word to our lives. And then we teach the word to the world. By holding fast the word of life, we establish our conviction in the truth of the word. So, do you diligently study the word of God every day? Have you applied it to your life 100%? Because the next step is to teach it. The next step is to teach it for all of us. Not just the evangelist standing up here preaching the word. It's every Christian's job, as we've seen today. And it just begins with a few simple commands. As discussed earlier, you cannot come to the Lord without first hearing the word, which leads you to faith, Romans 10:17. You must believe what you have heard and that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And if you don't believe that, you'll die in your sins. John 8:24. You can't just kind of believe this. This is something you have to fully believe 100%. The next command is that all men everywhere repent of their sins, Acts 17:30. Because if you do not repent, you will all likewise perish, Luke 13:1-3, 1-5, actually. The next step seems simple, but is very complex. You must confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, before men for him to confess you before his Father in heaven. Matthew 10:32, and we've learned through our studies that confessing Jesus as the Christ, your Savior, means you are confessing that you are going to be his slave. You no longer own your own body. You're going to give it, as we learned today, as a sacrifice to God. And when you become a Christian, this body no longer is your own. It is God's, for you to do as he says. You must then be baptized because it saves you. 1 Peter 3:21. Not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Then we must all live faithfully, walking in the light. 1 John 1:6-7. And we must do this even to the point of our own death. Revelation 2:10. If we want to receive a glorious crown of righteousness in heaven. If you have yet to follow these blessed commands, the waters of baptism are ready for you. If you find yourself falling short in study, application, and teaching God's word and need prayers of encouragement, we're here for you. Remember, prayers work. James 5:16. Let us pray for you if you need it. Whatever your need, please come forward as we stand and sing.
While Jesus whispers to you, come, sinner, come. While we are praying for you, come, sinner, come. Now is the time to own him, come, sinner, come. Now is the time to know him, come, sinner, come. Are you too heavy laden? Come, sinner, come. Jesus will bear your burden. Come, sinner, come. Jesus will not deceive you. Come, Jesus can now redeem you. Come, sinner, come. Oh, here is tender pleading. Come, sinner, come. Come and receive the blessing. Come, sinner, come. While Jesus whispers to you, come, sinner, come. While we are praying for you, come, sinner, come.
Please be seated. And as you do, turn to our closing song, which will be 756. 756. When we all get to heaven, let's just sing the first and the last verse.
Sing the wondrous story of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout, shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon it soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all, what a day of rejoicing that will be, when we all see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
Shout the victory.
Pray with me, please. Our Father, we thank you for the blessings of this Lord's Day and the opportunity that we've had to worship together. We thank you for each member, each family that's represented here. And we pray that this church might continue to thrive and grow. And we strive, Father, with your help to spread the gospel throughout Anchorage and Alaska and other parts of the world. Bless us, Father, as we do your will. Help us to truly put you first in our lives and to be examples to others that they might be drawn to Christ. Father, we pray for forgiveness of our sins and that your blessings will go with us now as we are dismissed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just a few quick announcements and we'll be dismissed. Don't forget our meetings, guys and gals, right after the worship service here. Both the men and the ladies will have their monthly meeting. There is a fall retreat. All the registrations are, information is in the entryway there. Again, a reminder of the fellowship dinner to be at the church's home at 6:30 on August 25th. There are some, there's quite a number of folks that are identified in the bulletin in need of prayers. There are some there that are under a special heading. Note who those folks are. A special emphasis for Bart Daniel. I spoke with him yesterday. He is doing a little bit better. He'll be back in Alaska with his family in about a week and a half. As we noted earlier, he had suffered a stroke. And don't forget that his wife had suffered a heart attack not too much before that. So they're both struggling with their health. Don't forget the Sacred Sister cards, lady. They're due. And if you haven't noticed, as you go through the entryway, there is something new on that table, if you haven't noticed it. And that's a business card. And if you haven't picked some of those out, I encourage you to do that. Keep it in your purse or your wallet. And when you talk to people, hand them a card about our congregation here. I have no other announcements, and we are dismissed.